Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you this morning. If you would, please stand, and we're going to open up with some worship.
Good morning. Welcome to Pleasant Hill. We are really glad to see everybody together today. And as we start off our service, just a few things I want to let you know about. First of all, the young adult group will not meet tonight. That's just been a change that's happened over the weekend. Men, we have men's breakfast this coming Saturday at 7:30 in the morning down in the fellowship hall. It takes about an hour. We eat a great meal. Then we have a great time of studying. Right now we're going through the book of James and prayer. We close out with prayer. And we would love for you to come and join us. And we also encourage you to bring your grandsons and your sons to come and join us as well. So that'll be 7:30 downstairs in the fellowship hall. Next week after this service, we'll be having a leadership team meeting. And then next Sunday night, the Change of Paces small group will be meeting at 6 p.m. at the Sharps House. And they're getting ready to start a brand new study called God's at War. And if you're interested, we can definitely get you connected with that group. They would love to have you come and join them. Then, as you look through, you'll see a couple other things that are coming up that I'm going to let you know about. One of them is the Touch-A-Truck event. We've talked about this over the last couple weeks, and this is just a great event to get to know our neighbors And we're really excited because the response from the community has been so good. We have all sorts of rescue vehicles, work vehicles, all sorts of different types of cars and trucks and farm equipment. And we hope, number one, that your family will come and join us. And number two, that you will consider helping out that day. In order to host this event, we're just going to need a lot of hands welcoming folks in. So if you're interested and willing, in the bulletin you'll see a form. You can fill that out. Drop that out in the foyer at that table with the black tablecloth, and we'll be in contact with you. If you've signed up already, we'll be giving you the details this week. And then also next week, everybody that signed up, we'll have free t-shirts for you to pick up and wear that day. If you have any questions, please let us know. And then our leisure group is going to be taking an overnight trip. It's April 4th and 5th to LaGrange, Georgia. And this is for anybody that wants to go. But in LaGrange, they have the Bible History Center, which recreates a lot of different sites and different types of housing from biblical times. So we'll be not only going through that center and looking at their archaeological display, which has about 200 pieces from Israel. We will also be eating a meal there. And it will recreate portions of kind of like a Passover meal, and it takes place in a Roman house. So it's just kind of a really neat trip, and we would love for you to be part of it. There's a sign-up sheet on the back window, and you just say, hey, I'm kind of interested in this, and the rest of those details will be coming out real soon. Kind of on a personal note, I mentioned this at the Wild Game Dinner, but I've really not talked about it during our service, but a lot of you know our middle son, Levi. And Levi is in college right now, and he has an opportunity this summer to go on a 10-week mission trip to Tanzania with Team Expansion, teaming up with missionaries there in a capital city. And we appreciate, as we've kind of posted online, or some of you have heard about it, we appreciate the prayers and the generosity that's been shown to him. We're real excited, and just ask you to praise God with us. When we knew he was going, it came with a large price tag. It's about $6,500 for the whole summer. And we weren't real sure how that was going to happen, but it is all paid off, and he's ready to go. So over the next couple weeks, please keep him in your prayers as he gets ready to go and team up serving in Tanzania this summer. And I'm sure we'll be talking about it a little bit more. At this time, will you please stand and join me as we open with a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, just how good it is to be able to just recognize that because of you, we trade our sorrows, we trade our sin, and we get such joy in our life. We thank you that in you we find the true pursuit of happiness that only you can provide. And we just pray today that you'll be honored through our time together. It's in your son's name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Everything that we do, you can turn it around and make it for you. We love you and we praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Oh, a happy day.
Happy day.
Oh, a happy day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus wore. Oh, when he wore. When Jesus
wore, when Jesus
washed the sins away.
Oh, happy day.
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 All right, if you are under the age of 25, raise your hand. People, that's a cassette tape. And that's how we used to listen to music. It's amazing how much things have changed, isn't it? But I love that song, Oh Happy Day. And I think probably for most of us, you look forward to those happy days, don't you? When you wake up in the morning, everything just goes really well. And sometimes maybe the morning starts off pretty happy, but before too long, maybe the day kind of slides down a little bit. We're kind of unique as a nation because in the preamble of the Declaration of Independence, it says that one of our inalienable rights is the pursuit of happiness. Somebody went up to Benjamin Franklin one time, and they kind of were disgruntled, kind of have an attitude, and they walked up to him and they said, "Mr. Franklin, where is this guaranteed happiness that you told me I could have?" And Benjamin Franklin looked at him and he said, "Sir, we say that we have the right to pursue happiness, but you have to catch it yourself." I think maybe if you look at statistics today, we'd recognize that as a nation, while we have the right to pursue happiness, we're not really catching it all that well. Statistics tell us that when it comes to a job, 60% of people say that they at least are somewhat unhappy at their jobs right now. 33% of people say they're absolutely miserable at their jobs right now. Every year there's a world happiness ranking, and what that world happiness ranking does is look at a number of different items that bring people happiness and figure out what nation around the world offers most of those things. What nation is the happiest? Finland has won for the last 6 years. I've never been to Finland. I don't know what makes them happy. But for us, you know where we land? Number 15. 33% of people, of Americans, actually say that they are happy. In a nation where we have the pursuit of happiness, sometimes it seems like we're not all that happy. What's even more revealing is when you begin to ask people what would make them happy. We probably can assume that for a lot of people, the things that would make them happy is spending more time with those they love, more stuff, the bigger house, the nicer car, the more toys, more money. One of the surveys decided to ask the folks, how much money would it take for you to be happy? Well, just for a minute, you don't have to say it out loud, but think about that number in your head. How much do you think it would take somebody to be happy nowadays? They took all these amounts, they boiled them together, averaged them out, and people said it would take $1.2 million to make them happy. But you know what? If they had $1.2 million, you know what they'd realize probably? They'd really be $1.3, $1.4. Is that in this pursuit of happiness, so often we think that our happiness is going to come from stuff, from everything being perfect, from our circumstances. But this week in the Core 52 reading, you'll realize that there's a lot more to it than that. And today we're going to look at a passage where it talks about being happy, kind of gives us a prescription for being happy. And in a nation where we have the right to pursue happiness, we've got to figure out where do we pursue it from? Where do we find it? And in Psalm chapter 1, we discover a happy person. Now, before we get into this psalm, just a couple of things. First, we're going to see the word blessed. In the scriptures, when we see this word blessed, a lot of times in the Old Testament, there's kind of two different ideas to it, depending on the word that's used that we translate blessed. One of those words for blessed is the favor of God. That's not the word that's used here. In this passage, when we see the word blessed, it literally means happy. It probably could even go a step further. Instead of happy, it could be translated, "Oh, how happy is the man." So we are talking about somebody in this psalm that God recognizes is somebody who's truly happy. Let's begin to read it. Psalm 1, verses 1 through 3. It says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yield its fruit in its season, and its leaves do not wither, and all that he does prospers." Here we find just a couple of short verses that describe this truly happy person. Now, as we've gone through the Old Testament so far this year, different passages there, we always want to stop and we wonder, where do we see Jesus? And St. Augustine says that when you read Psalm 1, 1 through 3, you see Jesus all over the place. Because Jesus truly is this blessed man. Because Jesus, we know when he came, he did not walk in a path of ungodliness, but was without sin. that he came and he didn't build an earthly kingdom, but instead built a heavenly kingdom. And Jesus, throughout his ministry, you see that he delighted in the word of the Lord and in his relationship with the Lord. And he prospered, certainly prospered, in all that he did. Here in Psalm 1, as he shows us this pursuit of happiness, it describes how to seek happiness, and it begins with a no, or negative. And that's kind of weird for us, because I think overall, as Americans, we have the right to pursue happiness. At the same time, we don't like the people to tell us no, do we? We want freedom. We want to do whatever we want. It bothers us. And when we read this psalm, one of the things that stands out is right away it begins with a negative. But a negative is often needed so you can get to a positive. Just think about an athlete. As they train and as they get ready to compete, there are certain things that they don't do. Maybe stay up late, watch TV. They're careful about the things that they eat, the things they're taking into their body, because they know that there's something greater they want to achieve. They say no so that eventually they'll be able to say yes. And that's the picture we find here in this passage. But look at what he says no to. The negative revolves around relationships. Because the people that you're with determine where you go. Over the last couple summers, our family has teamed up with my wife's family to go on vacation. And we've been able to go to some really neat places. And this summer, we're going out to Washington State, because my wife's brother is stationed out there in the Army. So they're having these big conversations, planning out how we're going to get all three of our families out there, and when we're going to be out there, and what we're going to do out there. And my brother-in-law, who lives out there, he posted a message the other day on Facebook. He said, everybody should go get their Stairmaster exercise equipment and start working out, because the best trails go up. Now, when I read that, I thought, I need to find some new people to vacation with, because I really don't want to go up. You know, if anybody's going someplace that goes flat, let me know. You know, if anybody wants to hike Iowa or something, let me know, because I don't want to go up. But the people that you're with determine where you go. And it's not just when it comes to hiking, but especially when it comes to living. And look what he says here. The first thing we say no to is, he says, you say no to walking with the wicked. Now, we see that word walk. He's not talking about necessarily just walking down the street. What he's talking about is, when we see walking in the Bible, it often describes a lifestyle. For example, in Genesis 5:24, in describing Enoch, it says Enoch walked with God, and one day he was not, and God took him up. It's describing the way that Enoch lived his life. He walked in a godly life. He walked in a way that honored the Lord. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, when Paul writes to Christians, he says this. He says, I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called. Paul writes and he says, I want you to walk differently in the way that you live than everybody else. He said, when you walk worthy, that is the lifestyle you live. It is the decisions you make. As followers of Christ, our life is totally changed than who we used to be. And it shows up in the way that we live. We don't make decisions like we used to, because we've been transformed. Maybe a good picture of this is, as you see some people walking or marching together, maybe in the army, and you wonder, you know, as they do that, they're such perfect in step with one another that it stands out. And I think Paul is warning us at the very beginning. He's saying, be careful of who you're in step with. He says, are you walking with the wicked? Now, we see that word wicked, and it really maybe jolts us a little bit. And usually if we see wicked, we think of the worst sort of people. But in this passage, there's only two choices. And we're God, there's only two choices. There's no median in this walk. It's either a righteous, somebody's life who's been transformed by Christ, or the wicked. You're either walking with Christ or you're walking away from Christ, is what he's saying here. And he's saying that we got to be careful of who we are in step with. Think about the messages that you are constantly taking into your life. What are those messages leading you on towards? The decisions you make in your life, are they in step with God's word, or are they in step with the world? Think about the things we take in. Maybe we sit back and we say, you know what, my life's not impacted by the people I'm walking with, but what about the the news that you watch, the political season that we're in. How many times are the messages that we're taking in determining how we walk, the decisions we make? Sometimes we got to step back and ask ourselves, who am I in step with? What he says is the path to happiness means you're going to say no to walking with the wicked. Secondly, it says no to standing in the way of sinners. The word used for sinners here is kind of a picture word. It's meant to grab the attention of the readers when they first saw it. And the word that's used of sinners, it meant to make a loud noise or to cause some sort of ruckus, provoke a riot, stir up trouble. When he talks about standing with those, he's saying you're staying with a group of people who are constantly causing angst everywhere they go. He doesn't mean that you stand up against them. Instead, it means that you are standing with them. Alistair Begg says, this is the dialogue that shapes our mind. Now, do you begin to see how this unfolds? He says, you say no to walking with the wicked. You think about somebody that you're just walking with. You know, you're going to have some short conversations. There's some impact going back and forth, but you keep moving. But then he stops and he says, you got to be careful of standing with the sinners. If you stop and stand, those conversations are becoming greater. The impact is becoming greater. And then he goes that we have to say no to sitting with a scoffer. A scoffer is probably not a word that we use a whole lot today, but a scoffer would be someone who doesn't appreciate good things or godly things. A scoffer is somebody who their words and their actions mock the things of God. Sitting with a seat of scoffers means that you're pretty cozy to this idea. And today, if we look at our culture, we'd say this is a pretty popular seat nowadays. But it's not the first time it's been popular. In Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20, in describing the culture around them, he says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil. Think about today. How often do we call evil things good in our culture? How many times do we redefine what sin is to make it more comfortable for us? That's the seat of a scoffer. And what the psalmist is showing us here is he's showing us how this spirals down away from God. We walk, we sit, we scoff, we mock, and it leads to destruction. Sometimes you have to say no in order to be able to say yes. And what he says is, if you want to be happy, that's not the path you take. It's a path that leads to destruction. But then, he says, shows us what we say yes to. And what we find is that we say yes to relationship with Christ. A happy person is defined by what he or she does. And it begins with delight. He says a truly happy person delights themselves in the Lord. Now, I like images. I like pictures. And when I think about that word delight, I think about when we had our first son, Tyson. He was probably about 3-4 years old. And in Missy, my wife's family, she has 5 siblings. He was the only child in that family at the time. And his aunts and uncles just loved him and spoiled him. And they used to try to see what they could get away with him. So one day, we're sitting at Steak and Shake. And we're a whole family's together, and we're having this conversation, and Tyson's kind of sitting down by some aunt and uncles, and they ordered him a milkshake. And we weren't really paying attention. But they bring out this big glass milkshake, and they set it in front of him, and then he goes to town. We kind of see it happening out of the corner of our eye. They give him the straw, so he sips a little bit and forget the straw. He has a spoon, forget the spoon. Pretty soon, it's his hand. And he dives his hand in that milkshake, and he's just slurping that thing up. It is all over him, you know. I mean, he's so excited about the milkshake, he's like, oh, you know, and it's in his hair, and it's on his face. And the whole time, man, he's just got the biggest smile on his face because he's diving into this milkshake. He's so excited about it. That is delight. You want to learn about delight? Go down to children's church and talk to the students about the teams that they're on or when they do well at school. Talk to them about the things that they love, and you are going to see a smile spread across their face. You're going to see a passion about these things, and that is this image that we have of a happy person. A happy person is wise enough and transformed enough by the Word of God that they're going to say no to the people who are going to lead them away from God. And the reason they say no is because they love God so much that they just want to delight in Him. They just want to be with Him. And what it says here is that a truly happy person delights in the law of the Lord. They meditate on the law day and night. How often do we describe our life by delighting in the Word of God and in our relationship with Him? On Sunday mornings when that alarm goes off, I know it's kind of early. I know you want to sleep in, but boy, we should delight in the opportunity we have to come together with brothers and sisters in Christ. And when you open up your Bible, instead of simply reading it because you feel like you absolutely have to or because of guilt, imagine how transformative it is to read it because you delight in God. You long to know Him. You want to read His Word. Psalm 34:8 says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him." The more you know God, the more you can delight in your relationship with Him. Tomorrow morning, when that alarm goes off and you're stirring because you have to go to work or get the kids to school, before your feet hit the floor, just pray simply and thank God for that day and ask Him to help you delight in Him. Let your relationship with God be what brings that smile across your face. Let your relationship with God be what motivates you, what brings you joy. When I think about this, I think sometimes maybe as parents we've missed the boat a little bit. When our kids are growing up, we want them to know God's Word so much because it's so important, which we do. And sometimes we teach them how to delight in the Lord, or we teach them how to know God's Word with how to truly delight in the Lord. How often do we teach our kids to not just memorize a verse, but to love the verse giver? How much do we teach them to know that it's not just a bunch of yes and no's and rules, but it's a relationship with a God who created them and loves them? Of all the things we teach our kids to love and delight in, the greatest is the Lord. And that's the relationship that's going to bring them true happiness. So what he describes is, he says, we say no to the negative and we delight in the Word of the Lord and we delight in our relationship with God and we meditate on His law day and night. Sometimes we think about meditation today, we think almost like a mystical sense to it. You know, we think about somebody's with legs crossed and arms up and in some sort of trance or something. And unfortunately, that's kind of our idea. So we kind of stray away from a biblical concept of meditating on God's Word. The word that's used for meditate here meant to coo or to mutter, even to talk to oneself. It could be used to describe an animal. If you ever walked up to a cow and you hear that kind of that low moo as they're eating, or for one of our dogs, if you rub his ear just right, you'll get a rrrr. That's the idea in this passage of meditating. It's something that's so close to the lips that it continually comes out. It's telling us that when we delight in the Lord, His Word is always going to be close to our lips. That we're going to think about His Word. We're going to chew on His Word. We're going to talk about His Word. Sometimes when we read the Word of God, it's almost like a marathon to see how many verses and chapters we can get through every day without ever stopping sometimes and thinking about what we're reading. I like in the Core 52 series that we're in right now, and if you don't have a book, there's some papers out there you can scan the QR code and order one, or let us know and we get you one. But every Thursday, there's verses, small chunks of verses to meditate on, to think about, to have that verse and just be able to let it bounce around in our minds, to be on the edge of our lips. In the book of Joshua, we find the Israelites are about ready to go into the land that God promised them. Moses has passed away. Joshua is about ready to take over. God comes to him, and in Joshua chapter 1, God is telling him that the task ahead is going to be difficult. In verse 7, it says, "Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful. Do everything written in it. Then you'll be prosperous and successful." Did you see what Moses or what Joshua was told? What Joshua was told, he's saying, listen, be strong and courageous. If God comes up to you and says, you need to be strong and courageous and really strong and courageous and very, very, very strong and courageous, watch out. Because you know the task is going to be huge. But there's a plan for success. And the plan for success for Joshua as their leader was to take the word of the Lord and think about it, make sure it was on his lips, that it was always in his mind, and to obey it. And then success is going to come. That's the pursuit of true happiness. It's delighting in the Lord and keeping his words close so that we can obey and follow him everywhere we go. So tomorrow morning, when you wake up, as you wipe the crust out of your eyes and holler across the house for the kids, thank God that he's with you. Ask him to help you delight in him that day. And then pick up your phone or turn on the light just for me. And just read a verse of scripture. Or two verses of scripture. Maybe start in the Proverbs. These little bite-sized pieces. And hold those words close to your lips all day. Think about them as you meditate. And what God is going to do in you, according to Psalms, is he is going to plant you and help you grow. It really becomes a cool picture of what God does in our life. Instead of walking in the way of the wicked, or sitting in the seat of scoffers, or standing with sinners, we're delighting in the Lord. We want to be with him. We're thinking about his word. And in verse 3, it says, "This person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yield its fruit in season, whose leaf does not wither, or whatever they do prospers." He says, listen, if you delight yourself in the Lord, you are like this tree. And if you've ever been down by a river or a creek or a little stream or a pond, you see some of these big trees that grow there. Skip Heisig, who's a preacher, says that in his neighborhood, everybody knows his tree. He said there's other trees in that neighborhood, but this tree stands out because this tree is just bigger than all the other trees. He says when you pull into the neighborhood, you'll see a lot of these same trees, but this one just towers above everything. And he said he could never really figure it out. You know, why this tree was so big. He said in his backyard, he has a goldfish pond that he takes care of. And he said one of the things that he has to do every day for that goldfish pond, he thought because of evaporation, was fill it up with water. So one day a friend comes over and says, you know, that goldfish pond that you're filling up with water, your liner's leaking. We need to replace the liner. So they go and they begin to drain the pond. They get the fish out. They get a new liner. They're getting ready to put it down, and they recognize that this big tree saw that like a giant sippy cup. It took a root, busted through the liner, stuck the root down into that pond, and this big tree was thriving because it had water to constantly soak up and absorb through its roots. That's the image of being planted by water we have here in Scriptures, is that the person who delights in the Lord, meditates on his word, is going to get the nourishment, the vitamins, the strength, everything we need to grow. Not solely because of what we do, but mostly because of what God is doing in us. And the result, it says that we're like a tree planted by streams of water. It yields fruit in the seasons. Your life begins to get transformed. Why are you so happy? Because your priorities change. You're not looking for happiness and stuff. You're looking and delighting for happiness in a relationship. Where you begin to develop the fruits of the Spirit, things like love and joy and peace. You begin to sit back and say, you know what? I'm not who I used to be. My life has changed. Maybe you've seen anger begin to go away. Maybe the way you talk begins to go away. Maybe the things you do, the things you scoff at, those things go away. Why? Because instead of walking with the wicked, you are delighting in the Lord. The fruit's not the reward. The fruit is the result. It's expected. And this big tree that he describes here, it doesn't wither when trouble comes. Instead, it prospers continually. There's a lot of people on a pursuit of happiness. But the only people that will find it are those who delight themselves in the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your word. And we pray that we will delight ourselves in you. That in you we find love, we find joy, we find truth, forgiveness, hope. We pray every day. We will desire to know you and your word more and more. It's in your son's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together.
Good.
there's a hymn that I've sang many times in my life. And part of that hymn goes, "Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood." Dad asked me earlier this week if I would do the communion meditation today. And to be honest, when I first started looking for something, I tried to find something that went along with the song "Goodness of God." But in all my searching, "Victory in Jesus" kept coming up. So I searched a little bit more. And I came across something, and as I was reading it, I thought, I've never thought of that song that way. And like I said, if you're like me, you've sang that song many times in your life. But it doesn't say "victory for Jesus." It says "victory in Jesus." It was not Jesus who needed a victory. It was not Jesus who had a sin problem. And it was not Jesus who was powerless against death. Jesus was not the one who was helplessly separated from God. But God loved the world so much that he gave his only son to accomplish what you and I could not do, to conquer sin and death, to restore our relationship with God. And we can be victorious in Jesus because the victory was for us, a profound expression of God's undying love for his children. Each week we come together to celebrate communion, to reflect on Christ's life and what it means to us as individuals and what it means to us as a body of Christ. Each and every week we celebrate the glorious resurrection, the evidence that he was all that he said he was going to be, that he is able to save, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, that he is love, he is the word, he is the light, he is the good shepherd, our king, our priest, our God, and most of all, our salvation. With communion, we must recognize that victory was not free. It came at a price, and he willingly suffered unspeakable humiliation and so much pain on that cross. It cost a broken body, innocent blood, for those things to be poured out for the redemption of our sins. And each week we remember his broken body with the bread and his shed blood with the cup. And in doing this, we proclaim his death and we proclaim victory in Jesus. Will you pray with me? God, this morning we thank you for that victory. We thank you for that sacrifice, knowing that without you there is nothing that we could do. And you bridge that gap with the cross. God, we thank you. We love you. We praise you. We are in awe of you. And we come before you each and every time, thanking you for your goodness. In your name we pray. Amen.
So when we talk about delighting in the Lord being what brings true happiness, realize that it brings true happiness because God doesn't change. He's dependable. We can trust Him. He makes that happiness possible. Instead of looking for happiness in situations or stuff or relationships here on earth that are constantly changing, we delight in the one who never changes. But I want you to know that it's not always easy. Sometimes you read this and you think it seems like it just happens like that. But I think continual delight in the Lord sometimes is difficult. I think it's something that over the last couple months that I've had to deal with a little bit. About middle of November, my wife Missy's looking online, and one of our goals was for our kids, I mentioned a mission trip earlier for Levi, but that we were hoping for, they got to high school, that each of them would be able to do some sort of mission trip, I'm thinking like a week or two, and she finds this online, it says 10 weeks, and he's like, yeah, I think I want to do that, and they're like, what do you think? I'm thinking, for me, happiness is everybody at home safe, and I said, well, where do you think about going? And he said, I'd like to go to Tanzania. And I'm like, yeah, I know, because I delight in the Lord. I know the Lord loves the world. But it made me to go somewhere else. So we said, well, let's see. The deadline's coming up. You may not be able to get in. Oh, that's a good fatherly thing, you know. You just may not be able to make it, but let's try. He gets in. Then he's like, it's a lot of money. And we're like, well, we'll just have to see. And then we realized we saw the wrong number. It was like $1,000 more than we even thought. I'm like, this is good. He'll stay here because he cannot raise the money. Then his supervisor says, people must like you because you have had more money come in than we have ever seen in this program. And I was excited for him. But at the same time, there's part of me as dad that says, I want it to go my way. So I do some research about Tanzania. I hear he's going to be in the capital city. Capital city's pretty safe. I'm like, okay, that's a win. And then he says, yeah, we're going to ride a bus into Kenya. Border towns are not so safe. And then they're like, hey, you guys need to meet with the director of security for our organization. And there's all these things. And at the same time, I know that God is doing something really great in this opportunity for him. But I know sometimes it's hard to delight in the things of God because we like our plan better. Does that make sense? And it's not just in that trip. That's just kind of a silly example of it. Maybe you look at some relationships right now and you realize that what's keeping you from delighting in the things of the Lord is because you're walking with the wicked. And there's a choice to be made. There's some influences in your life that don't need to be there. Maybe there's some changes that need to take place so that you can truly be happy in the Lord. Delighting in the Lord, I don't think it just comes like that all the time. Sometimes it's a struggle. Sometimes it's about giving up because God wants to give you something better. Sometimes it's about a verse that you know, you're going to meditate on it. You're going to keep meditating on it because it's difficult. Maybe there's a struggle. But I can tell you this, is that when you delight in the Lord, the scriptures tell us He gives us the desires of our heart. Because our heart is a reflection of Him. Today, if you had to figure out of the things you really delight in, the things that bring you joy, satisfaction, a smile, happiness, what is it? Scriptures tell us, Psalm 1 tells us, if it's anything else but the Lord, it just will not last. Oh, but when we delight in Him and in His Word, in His Spirit, in our life, He gives us a happiness that weathers the storms. He gives us a happiness that plants us by the water where He nourishes us and we grow and we flourish, and there's going to be some struggles that come sometimes, but when we delight in Him, He's going to be there for us. Today, there's a lot of things that the world says will make you happy. But unless it's Christ, it will never bring true happiness, because it's all temporary. So delight yourself in the Word, in the Lord. Meditate on His Word. Love the things He loves. And your heart is going to be full. And today, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we invite you to come forward as we stand and sing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, just help us to delight in You. Help us to make sure and recognize that You're our source of strength, of happiness, of peace. Help us to just evaluate through Your Word and our life, keep it in step with. To get on the right track. It's in Your Son's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. You guys have a blessed week.